in order to achieve what? Sanity. We are seeing a lot of sickness in Saints right now. And as a result of that sickness, they're having a lot of death. So, when we reassert that sense of agency, meaning a sense that we know we have the power to shape our realities, things will change because we will be empowered, and we need to claim this empowerment. It enthrones the centrality of African ideas and values. So everything you think, say, or do will have that African essence. It is centered in our lives, in our being, in the way we make love, in the way we worship, in everything, the way we cook, in the way we dance. It is there in the way we dance and the way we do other things. We just don't know what it is that makes us live or we behave. But a lot of the good side of what we do and the ways in which we are strong and powerful, which is mainly our culture, is African, central, and values. We used to teach our children to speak to everybody, say good morning, say good afternoon. There was a time when you got beaten by your parents if some older person said you passed up on the street and did not speak. We had in Ethiopia, some man came up to me not long ago and said, before, but he's been watching me. He said, I really like the way you talk to everybody on the street. I said, I don't know how to not do it. It's a part of me because I was raised by an African grandmother who was born on a little island called Anguilla. But we have to go to the highest forms of African culture because every culture has high forms and low forms. Even African culture is not all glorious goodness. There are some low forms, but we have to go to the highest ideals and values. And activate our consciousness. This consciousness might us drive how we do things, how we live, how we think, how we are, our being. So you become conscious of yourself as an African, and it is reflected in how you dress, in how you live. And it must be an aspect, a functional aspect of any revolutionary approach to phenomena. And we as Rastafari people, we have created a revolution. Because we decided we were going to be free Africans. We were going to emancipate ourselves from mental slavery. We looked to Africa and guess what we found? A black man that we know to be God. This is Rastafari. This is the consciousness. So we don't look to the sky for any coming and coming. We look deep inside of us and find what is there to be unleashed. I want to remind those of you who have a Christian faith. You know Jesus, I know him good. I'm a Christian. That's my name and my nature. And I want you to remember the walking on water incident. Remember, he was the only one who was walking on water. You know, he told him, he set out. And then one day prayed. And remember what happened. The other story. But maybe they didn't understand it. So which was the last time you walked on water? Put up your hand. It's done. And it wasn't only Jesus who did it.
Peter.
So my brothers and sisters, when he said, I'm going to walk to leave it. What are the roots of this thing? As I said, it came out of the Caribbean in the 19th century. And you hear some names like Edward Wilmot Blyden. We're going to look at him in detail a little bit later on. Edward Wilmot Blyden, we're going to talk about him when we talk about him. Henry Smith Williams came from Trinidad. So did George Padmore. Do you remember his real name? George Padmore was a name he used as a writer. Marcus Messiah Garvey remains in my mind, giant amongst them all. And I'm not going to talk about them today. But Garvey was married to two women named Amy. My little niece asked me today if he had two wives at the same time. No. He married Amy Ashwood first, and then it was a really nasty divorce. She never accepted. She always said there's only one, Mrs. Garvey and it's me. But she was a bright one. We're going to say a little bit about her later. And then Amy Jakes Garvey, who was the bridesmaid at Amy Ashwood's wedding. Before the income divorce papers read properly, he was married to Amy Jakes. And that marriage survived, and they had two children and so on. And she, Jakes, is the one who put out Garvey's philosophy and opinions and what have you. We know a lot more about Garvey today. But two women who had made their own map, they weren't just Garvey's wives. They had made their contribution to Pan-African thought and development. Let's look at some of the giants. What a man. Edward Wilmot Blyden, born in St. Thomas and the West Virgin Islands. In those days, it was depicted without the days, the stage. But his parents were three people from Nigeria, Igboland. They were living and stationed in the St. Eustatius. Blyden was a churchman, a preacher, and he used the tracts, you know those gospel tracts that people give out? He put out his Pan-African a little bit more about him. He was born in 1832, died in 1912. He was one who actually repatriated and went to live in Liberia. And then we have my favorite guy, Marcus Messiah Garvey. Now, look at Garvey's dress. You know about Garvey, and he ended up being Jamaica's first national hero. And we're going to talk about him a little more tonight. But you notice, in spite of their Pan-African consciousness, and Garvey said, everybody looks at God through their spectacles. And as Ethiopians, because they were Ethiopians in their thinking, we have to look at God through Ethiopian eyes. But look at how they're dressed. They're dressed in the highest fashion of European standards. So it means that there was still a bit further to go than these great men went. Now, another guy, another great man that we all need to know about. And as I said on the radio today, this lecture is a bit frustrating because each of these people presented here tonight really need to have their own lecture. So Brother Bridges and Brother Dabu, Brother Watts, Sister, I hope you all will take this up and carry it on. Every community center must get a little touch of this. And I'm quite willing to leave this with you so that you can add your research and enrich it and add in the same its names and so on. It's like a kind of Wikipedia. Take it and do something with it. Nkrumah sometimes wears shirt and tie, you know, it's coat and tie. But he celebrates in this picture the Kente, which existed before the Bible, which was a source of power and strength in the Gold Coast, that's what they call it. It is now called Ghana. And Kwame Nkrumah was the first president of Ghana, who, as we shall see later, was a Pan-Africanist in his law and in some of the things he did. I think this one is a man I would have loved to meet because he was just so brilliant and I admired brilliance. She got a job from Senegal. I don't think these are the kinds of people we need to be taught in our schools,
Senegal,
and our communities, and our homes, and our everywhere. She got a job.
That to kill him to
and
stop
finally,
him.
One of our other brilliant sons from the University of Life, Robert Mesternan. I want you to look at these images and you will see a kind of progression. You will see the suit and tie, you will see the Kente because he had a point to make. And the job with all his brilliance and so on, he was, you know, educated in Paris. We don't even know about that later. Now look at Brother One. No suit and tie thing for Brother One. He's a socialist brethren and and you can see a progression. When the Afro came in first, you know, people in the Caribbean who were in the civil service were sent home. And when braids came in later, people were sent home for wearing their hair in a natural African style. And so you see the progression go to the heights of heights in terms of ear and expressions of blackness to ear and expressions of naturality and universality. And now everybody is wearing today's style. But for some of us, when you see the locks of pretty and even and what have you, you know, that was a hairdresser's job. When you see Alec Max, you know that the hairdresser was a big hairdresser and one who didn't use any chemicals and things, you know? So the hair is a statement. We present ourselves to the world and make a certain statement. Blyther was the one who first talked about the actress, and I'm talking about the positive. So there is something, in common in the way black people behave. And Blyther referred to this as the African personality. One of his many articles that he wrote on Pan-Africanism was entitled Africa for the Africans. And Garvey took that another line to say, those at home and those abroad. Blyther urged black people to understand us. Remember, every time I said black people and Africans and so on, I'm talking about us in this room. And he said to us that we must reconnect to Africa as a source of power and wealth. And he went further to talk about us. He said, among the free portion of the descendants of Africa, when he spoke, we were about 4 or 5 million. Today, Africans number 1.5 billion. The The Chinese are 1.34 billion. And I want to talk about the Chinese because we kind of grumble at them and say they're taking over the world and whatnot. They don't have anything that we don't have. Besides, they're here, they say, let's do it. And they're doing it. I was like, we have to be watching it and looking at ourselves and saying, hey, what's going on? He said, at that time, among the 3, 4, 5 million of us outside of Africa, there's enough talent, wealth, and enterprise to form a respectable nationality on the continent of Africa. Gandhi also had that vision, we shall see, that we must return home and be a nation. In February, I was at an African Union meeting in South Africa, and a man from Barbados was calling for the same thing, David Commission, one of the region's noted Pan-Africanists. He again called for lands to be set aside in Africa by the African governments to accommodate this nation. A lot of us are afraid to go because we can't cite up what we're going to do it. So Gandhi said Africa, like he said Africa for the Africans, Gandhi said those at home and those abroad. Gandhi created a global organization of Black African people and developed a number of economic structures in which members and non-members invested. Gavi envisioned an independent Africa diaspora nation in Africa and used powerful symbols to engender global solidarity, commitment, and action. When we say global people, that means Saints and Nevis included, and us personally in this room. Yeah? He purchased at least 3 ships for the Black Star Line to facilitate global trade among Black people.